right, good evening, everyone. Today is Tuesday, January 2nd, 2018. The time is 7:34 p.m., and I hereby call this meeting of the Bedford School Committee to order. To do so, we will begin with a roll call vote. Ms. Gway.
Present.
Ms. Scoville.
Present.
Ms. Santiago.
Present.
Mr. Brosgall.
Present.
And I am present. We are all here. I want to welcome Chris Coles as our student representative tonight. Chris, thank you for making the time to be here. And we will begin, as we always do, with commentary from the public. Do we have a public willing to make comment? Seeing no comment or public, we will move on to our personnel report. Mr. Sills.
Yes, in December we had two teaching assistant resignations, Nate McMillan, JGMS, and Carly Brogan at the high school. Christina Barbacano went on maternity leave from the central office. And we hired Nettie Baratan as a long-term substitute teaching assistant at JGMS. Shannon Fama as a 0.6 teaching assistant at the preschool, and Jessica Baker as a permanent building sub at Davis. And that is it for the. I have some extracurricular to give to Nancy.
Okay.
We also have a contribution from Michael Luders from Luders Environmental, Inc., and he has made a contribution of $50 to the school department.
And we need a motion for that, correct?
We do.
So I'll accept the motion from any member of the committee to accept a $50 donation by Michael Luders on behalf of Luders Environmental.
So moved.
Dan moves.
Second.
Joanne seconds. Any discussion? Well, let's take a vote then.
This is an annual gift, I think.
This is an annual gift, indeed. Yep.
Thank you.
Indeed, yes, thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, say no. Any abstentions? That one is approved 5-0-0, and we thank Mr. Luders for his support. Is that it for the personnel report?
That is it.
Nice and easy. Excellent. The next item on our agenda are the budget discussions. So, Mr. Sills, again.
Well, I may be standing. Hold on a minute.
Would it be helpful to hit the lights?
Yeah.
Thanks, Dave.
There we go.
There we go.
Yeah, the bulb may be going. So I'm pleased to present the culmination of a lot of work on behalf of the school department. Particular thanks go to Dave Coelho for crunching all the numbers and making sure that our last year's budget is all aligned appropriately so we can begin to project and move forward. If you remember, about a month ago, I presented a 10,000-foot view of what we're expecting to see in superintendent's request for FY19, and now we're coming to the details. I think it's always important to ground our budget discussions in our community's expectations for the schools, and so I'm going to take the time to read through these. Bedford and the parents of our Bedford students in Boston and on the base all expect high-performing schools that nurture intellectual curiosity, creative expression, independent thinking, and skillful problem-solving. They expect a supportive, safe, and caring school culture that promotes an appreciation of diversity, intellectually engaging and challenging liberal arts learning experiences for all students, robust music, arts, and wellness courses for all students, ample athletic and extracurricular opportunities for all students, college and career readiness for all as a result of anywhere between 1 for our transient students and 12 years of schooling, K through 12. 21st century STEM, which is our science, technology, and math program, and technology-infused learning experiences. A commitment to educational equity and closing achievement gaps for groups of students that are not performing at the levels that we would like them to perform. Measurable and clearly identified learning outcomes, and cost-conscious planning that respects the community's fiscal conditions. So the budget that I'm going to present is essentially school department's understanding of what's needed to be able to meet those expectations in the coming year. We begin with what we call our maintenance of effort budget. And the maintenance of effort budget, if you remember, is essentially taking everything that we're presently doing and moving forward a year, increasing costs by cost of living, any contractual obligations, and essentially what's needed, not necessarily to ensure the same level of delivery, but essentially the same program that we have now. And at present, that maintenance of effort budget would be $40,109,985, which is which is 1.048424 million more than the FY18 approved budget of $39,061,561, or a 2.68% increase. So essentially, just moving everything forward already puts us at 2.68%. When we add the items that we think are necessary to maintain the level of service that we expect and to grow our programs in a way that meets the needs of all kids, that would require an additional approximately $636,730 and would end up with an overall budget of $40,746,715, which is a 4.31% increase. I think it's worth noting that the Finance Committee has set school departments' expected increase at 3.5%, and so we're about 0.81% over that guideline. And our goal here is certainly primarily to meet the needs that we lay out for our students and for our staff in order to meet the needs of our students, but wherever possible to strive to meet that guideline. So I think it's always helpful to just put in perspective our budget history. Give me a second. That slide's been adjusted. No, that's right. That's right. I'm sorry. In the early 2000s, our budgets were in the 7, 8, 9% range. Then there was an agreement with the Finance Committee in the mid to late 2008, 2009, 2010 to try to bring it down to around 4%. That was achieved in 2010, 2011. 2012, of course, was the budget that felt the economic downturn most directly, and that was actually a negative 0.79% budget. I think it's instructive to note that for the last 2 years, 2017, 2018, we were able to meet the Finance Committee guideline and do that in a way that made us feel confident that we were still meeting the needs of the department. And our kids. And this year, our projected needs are at 4.31%. And if I'm happy to go all the way through before we have questions, but if there's questions along, just please feel free. So I think it's worth noting that our maintenance of effort budget is 98.4% of the total request. That only leaves 1.6% worth of expansion beyond our maintenance of effort budget. You can see that our total increase of $1.6 million is made up of the maintenance of effort increase, which is $1.048 million, and then the new request, $636,000. Our principal cost centers, and this is this is the same year after year. Our biggest cost center, we're in the teaching business, the people business, is always salaries, personnel, at 81.8% of the total. Our instructional materials, text and technology, 6.4%. Regular and special education transportation, 4.9%. And our out-of-district placement, 6.8%. So there are five key budget drivers for this year's projected FY19 budget, making up the additional or the expansion items worth $636,730. First one is enrollment, both in terms of its absolute numbers and in terms of the complexity of our changing population. Second is expanded building space and the needs that that imposes on us for maintenance and for keeping our facilities clean. Third is special education. Fourth is program improvements in terms of personnel, and then program improvements in terms of resources. So first driver is enrollment. I think it's worth noting that our enrollment needs to be understood in two ways. Number one, that it has grown and continues to grow and is projected to continue to grow out the next 10 years. And that's putting kind of absolute pressures on our classroom class size, and we'll be calling this year for the addition of one regular classroom teacher at the elementary level and some additional teaching at the secondary level. But at the same time that our numbers are growing, the complexity of our student body is also growing. And that complexity requires different kinds of programs than we had 15 years ago when we had a much more homogeneous population. So, and I shared some other figures with you that show the changes over a longer period of time, where our low-income students, our students of color, our ELL populations have grown 300-400%. But I think it's instructive just to note the numbers that we have between 2016-17 and this year, 17-18. Our ELL population is on the rise again, going from 5.3% last year to 6.0% this year. And except for this blip in 15-16, which was truly impacted very strongly by the hotel and by our homeless students, we're seeing a steady increase, into the present. The number of students for whom English is not their first language not English, is up to 16.5% of our students, which is a very significant number of students in terms of our overall population. 6% of our students, by the way, with 2,600 students, is about 180 students who are in ELL classes. Our students with disabilities has actually declined some, and that's a very positive sign. Can't tell whether that's a trend or not, but it's significant for us at the moment. Our African American population, 6.1%. Our Latino, 4.2%. Our Asian population has grown steadily over the last 6 or 7 years to 16%. Our mixed population has grown as well, 6.7%. And so our overall non-white population, students of color, are 33%, one-third of our population. I want to note that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education uses a new metric for low income, and we don't have the number for this year. That usually comes out a little later. But if you were to go on the DESE website, you would actually see for 16-17 8.4%, which would look like it's a decline from the preceding years. But in fact, it's calculated differently now, and the figures that the department gives us suggest that the actual numbers based on the old metric, the old formula, is about 40-50% higher than the current number. So when you apply that multiplier, we would actually be at about 12.24 using the old formula. So our numbers there are growing as well. In terms of numbers, not complexity, but actual numbers, our total population that was expected in FY17 panned out to be 26-23. We projected that we would grow by about 40 students in FY18 to 26-57, and we actually exceeded that by about 5 students. And we're projecting that for next year we'll be at 26-82. But I think that the important numbers to look at here are at Lane and JGMS. Davis is essentially holding tight at the larger number that jumped by about 50, 60 kids in 2012 and is expected to grow by another 20 or 30 in the next several years. But Lane is steadily increasing now. So 566 in 17, projected 603 in 18, actually 610 in 18, and should go up to about 628 next year. And JGMS, which was at 556 in 17, projected at 582 in 18, ended up this year at 584. That will dip slightly. But it's already grown considerably over 2 or 3 years ago. So our numbers overall are growing, but we're feeling it particularly at Lane School, and we're feeling it at JGMS from some unexpected growth over the last 2 years. Long-term projections, I won't go through this whole table, but just to give you an idea, if we go out to 27-28, this is the NESDEC updated projection. They're looking at that it's going to climb in 21-22 and hold basically steady through 27-28. The Space Needs Task Force predicted that this would be about 10 more students than this, 626, somewhere in that range. So either way, considerably higher than we were in 2012. Our 3-5 is going to get up to 650 and kind of steady around 647. Our middle school, 676, and our high school is going to break 1,000 for the first time since the 1970s. I will say, and this came up in a recent meeting of the Davis School Building Committee, all of these projections are without taking into account what's now being considered, which is turning, is it the Bedford Hotel?
Motel.
Into rental units. So we'll see what that impact is. So our elementary class size, if we look at the present, our class size averages at kindergarten 22, first grade 22, third grade 23, fourth grade 23, fifth grade 24. If you remember, our guidelines for K through 2 are 18 to 20. So we're already over those guidelines. In FY19, if we don't add another teacher at Lane School, we're going to continue to be over our guidelines at Davis, and we're offsetting this at the kindergarten by having an additional interventionist until we have enough space to go to 10 classrooms. But at the Lane School, we end up being at 26.2 in fifth grade, which is simply not acceptable. So the solution to that is to propose the addition of one classroom teacher for fifth grade for next year, and that will bring our Lane School numbers within guideline. Yes?
I've had people ask me what makes that increase in class size so bad when other towns do it. What is the challenge and what are we trying to avoid? What benefit does reducing the class size by three students do?
Well, I think that you're going to find that Bedford's philosophy of education, which is to move more and more towards student-centered work, where students are not kind of in large group receiving lots of information, but they're actually engaged in collaborative learning experiences, in a higher level of participation, more self-directed work. We also break students down because we have such a complex student body, both in terms of all the different levels of diversity, but particularly in terms of learning styles and learning needs. Consistently, we break them into smaller groups within the classroom, and the teacher needs to, or the teacher and the teacher aide needs to be able to get to each of those groups to give more direct instruction and to respond to the particular learning needs of the students. When you have 25, 26, 27 students. Students are just simply, they're not getting the attention that they need. The teacher's ability to differentiate instruction and deliver different kinds of instruction to different groups is compromised. I think when we saw more of that, it was at a time when classes were more homogeneous and where instruction was much more teacher-directed and top-down. We just don't have that expectation in terms of instruction anymore, and we don't have that student body anymore. We have students within each classroom who have some very challenging learning needs. Sometimes they're behavioral. And our philosophy of inclusion, which is to have all students in the mainstream wherever possible, requires that we do that. And those students need very particular attention. And when you increase the numbers of students like that beyond a certain critical mass, their behaviors begin to dominate and distract from the other students being able to engage in the way they do. That's how I would answer it.
I might also just add that if you look at 26.2, that means one class is 27. Mm-hmm. So that means someone's in a class of 27. Sometimes we see, okay, 26. That's, at least it's not 27. But for 27 students, it is 27. And then the other piece I would say is, adding to John's piece, is that I think what we're asking teachers to do at that point is to manage rather than instruct. And so more of their time is spent on management of behavior rather than actual instruction. So I think that's key. Having said that, Joanne's questions are great. What I think that should probably be in a budget presentation, like what really are the top five reasons why 26 is unacceptable? Because I think we say that a lot. We just say, you know, that's unacceptable. Bedford never let that happen. But it's worth, exactly like John, just to find it, just throwing a slide in there. Mary Lou, I didn't mean to cut you off if you have something.
No, that's fine. I do think that once you get past 23 or so, one or two students makes a huge difference in actually trying to get those groups to work and manage things and get to individuals. So,
and are we sure that, I know as we push more and more kids in and try to include them, especially, and you're mentioning kids with challenging behaviors, that we have the supports there because it becomes all the, I mean, we don't include kids that aren't ready to be included, correct? We don't push kids in that aren't ready and without the proper supports.
They're
just not in there to be in there. They're in there to learn. And so sometimes they will not be in there or be in there for the whole day.
Yeah.
So when we look at a number and sees 27 in a classroom, some of those kids are not in there all day. They're...
Yeah, well, I think in this case, the devil's in the detail. I'd have to look at each specific classroom and which one has 27.
Although I'd assume if you put a really behavioral kid in a class, it would be a smaller classroom.
Right.
I can't
so that's why it's likely not the case. But yes, and that's why we build a budget to try to provide those supports.
But some kids just can't be, and they won't be.
And then we have alternatives for them. And sometimes you don't know until you try, because it's not an absolute. You know, you work with a kid to get them to the point where they can, and you put the supports there, and then 2-3 weeks later, the child has a meltdown, and you realize you're not quite there yet.
Yeah, I would just add to that that you know, at the heart of inclusion, the philosophy of inclusion is being included, not just attending, right? So I think
fully
for a long
included.
Time there were sometimes kids in class technically, and it was called inclusion, but I think that Bedford's philosophy is certainly about, if we're going to call it inclusion, that mm-hmm. a child must be able to be included. Mm-hmm. And whether that requires, you know, additional adult support in order to be included or other supports, that's what we've been trying to provide. That's a good question.
I'd say one last thing, which is that there's no question that there are high-performing districts that may have higher class size. My guess, and I've done a fair amount of research around this, that in most cases they don't have the level of complexity that we have, that they have more homogeneous classrooms.
And I can't help myself, but the complexity is a good thing for the district.
Absolutely.
The fact that we have kids from all different backgrounds and speaking multiple languages, sometimes it's presented, I know you don't do it, but it reads almost like that mm-hmm. this is a negative, when actually it's really an excellent aspect of the district.
Yeah, because when you graduate and you go on to college and you go on to work, you have to deal with different people, right. people with different, and it's not just the languages and the cultural backgrounds, but it's also the challenges that, you know, kids who might have behavioral or learning mm-hmm. disabilities, and you just, in the workplace, you have to learn to deal with everybody and might as well start.
Yeah.
So I might just add in that, you know, one of the things I think that Bedford, I think, has done well is to look at we've looked at sort of traditional measures, SAT, achievement tests, MCAS, all things like that. But I think that if you were to look at other measures, you know, student stress, connection to an adult, you know, all the sort of social emotional keys, risk-taking behavior, you know, healthy decision-making, those things that are harder to quantify, but at the same time, I think we look at our youth risk behavior survey data and things like that. That's where class size matters, and it doesn't always show up on that MCAS score, but when kids are feeling more connected to an adult, when kids are feeling like they've gotten an adult's attention, then they're going to develop socially and emotionally in a way that other maybe higher performing districts maybe might not be. So there are some districts that put more kids in a class that achieve better, but I would just say achieve better on traditional measures and on the measures that are really meaningful to kids and families and parents, such as student stress, connection to an adult, social emotional learning, resilience, curiosity. I think class sizes are a critical component of that. And it's harder to draw that straight line, but I can just tell research bears it out that it's absolutely a line to be drawn.
But it's also around, I guess what you're saying is classroom management, mm-hmm. that if you're going to be, because the literature suggests class size, it has to be much smaller.
Mm-hmm.
That if you go to 20, it doesn't matter, unless you're going to go to 14. The literature doesn't
literature
really support
to traditional testing measures.
Correct.
It
doesn't. The literature doesn't support a classroom of 20. But if we do it with the right supports and manage it and try to meet the needs of mm-hmm. the, and I'm assuming the teachers buy in, this is what they want to do, and it's effective and it works. Mm-hmm. Other districts just don't choose to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And do we know who does what? Do we track that? Who?
Oh yeah. Okay. I mean, most of the districts that we compare ourselves with, you know, have class sizes like ours, if not lower. And we stand out amongst the districts that we compare ourselves with in terms of our complexity. And I'm glad you raised that in my narrative, and I didn't include that in my introduction here. That is part of what makes us so special, that our kids get to learn in a very real world setting, and they get to learn from each other. So I'm proud that we have the kinds of traditional scores and the other kinds of positive metrics, and we have a very complex student body.
And the data is great about percentages of income and educational levels and languages, but every kid's an individual, and there are going to be students that, you know, there'll be students that come from affluent backgrounds that are profoundly disabled, or kids that come from low-income backgrounds that are fabulous students. So it's just helpful to help us paint the district, but it's not suggesting that we're putting kids in buckets and saying this is positive, this is, because I think that sometimes the narrative gets lost on folks, mm-hmm. that they'll start saying, well, we've become so complex, that's a detriment, and it's not at all. And it just doesn't line up like that, so get off my soapbox.
Thank you. Along with our larger numbers at Lane, in terms of just general class size issues, this has also put a lot of stress on our reading support and the importance of our being able to provide direct reading instruction to students who need it. And so we're asking, along with those larger numbers at Lane, to also increase a reading teacher there by 0.5 to make that teacher whole. So the overall cost to the town in this case, in terms of benefits, would just be associated with the new classroom teacher and not with the reading teacher. So approximately $19,500. Over the last couple years, we saw an increase in numbers at JGMS sooner than we had originally predicted when we did our space needs enrollment studies and verifications of the NESDEC. We thought that that would really begin to really kick in around 1920, but it started 2 years ago. And that exacerbated a serious issue of having 20, 25 specials, classes, art, music, et cetera, with classes of 27, 28, 29 kids. And in the FY18 budget, we gave some relief to that by adding some art and music FTE. Now we're seeing the pressure in foreign language. These are the class sizes presently for Spanish 1 and 6th grade Spanish. That's just not sustainable. Our numbers at JGMS may go down 5 or 10 students. It's not going to directly significantly impact this. So we have a real enrollment issue that we want to relieve in terms of foreign language. But there's also a programmatic need. And the programmatic need is that we're proud that we offer foreign language starting in the third grade. And it's really a fabulous, fabulous program. We wish that all kids could take advantage of it in third grade. But there are students whose reading skill deficiencies are so significant that if we don't remediate in time, those problems are going to kind of change. They're going to follow them all the way through the rest of their schooling. And so there's a relatively small number of kids who we encourage their parents to have them opt out of foreign language in third, fourth, and fifth grade so they can get additional reading support. Historically, we haven't had a good entrance place for them when they got to the middle school. They would join a classroom of kids who've already taken foreign language and feel badly about themselves and feel like they're never really catching up. So with this 1.0, we not only want to bring down these numbers, but we want to create some new sections specifically designed for kids who are coming to the middle school and will take foreign language for the first time, and that will begin their journey that will then go up through the high school in Spanish.
And are we able to include more children with IEPs at the middle school in foreign languages? Because for a while it used to be that that's when all the services were done. Are more students able to take advantage of that now?
This would make that more possible, yes. Mm-hmm. So we're asking for a 1.0 foreign language teacher who can do Spanish and French, and 65-766, which is our M5, David, is that
yes.
M5? Average, and again, with the benefit cost of the town. The third area that we're seeing enrollment growth again is in ELL. And Last year, we had 146 kids. This year, we have 157 kids. And amongst 157 is a significant number, 10 kids at level one. And many of the kids at level one actually have no English at all. The languages that are represented by families whose kids don't know any English over the last couple of years have been Italian, Vietnamese, Spanish, Russian, Hebrew. So a very interesting range of kids whose families have immigrated to the United States, and we're happy to have them. But they need services. And our ELL program has been extremely successful. Our kids, by the time they are ready to take our MCAS tests, et cetera, are actually doing quite well for students who are just learning the language. In order to meet this need, we want to add 0.5 FTE of an ELL teacher and create a program administrator position. So we have right now three teachers at Davis School, 1.8 teachers at Lane School, I'm sorry, 1.9 teachers at Lane School, 1.0 at the middle school, and 1.0 at the high school. And there's no program leader for those teachers like we have for every other department. We're paying one teacher a stipend to work with Mary Lou to do a lot of the data work, we're well past the time where we need to actually have a department with real administrative leadership. There's a lot of work that goes into being a leader of an ELL program. There's testing constantly, a lot of data work, a lot of evaluation of kids when they're ready to move on, a lot of support and program professional development for the teachers. So we want to add, take away the coordinator position and make it a PA. Which is a difference of about $3,500.
$3,700.
That's one person.
We presently have a 1.0 at the high school. Because our numbers are low there, we would reduce that by 0.5 and move that to the Lane School. So we're actually adding a whole body at the elementary level, but it's only costing us half the cost. Okay. So that between the stipend for the PA and the 0.5, that would be $42,756. Because it would be a new body, there would be a cost to the town.
Could I ask a question? So on this chart, the ELP, I don't know what ELP means, but it appears that it's one is the lowest level of fluency and five is greater fluency in English.
That's correct.
Okay.
Thank you for pointing that out.
Because of English language proficiency levels.
Yeah.
Okay.
The law has also changed this year, and students who essentially graduate out of ELL, they get a five and then they're ready to no longer have services, direct services. Now our teachers are required to follow them for, is it 4 years?
4 years.
Four more years. So it used to be only 2 years. So in essence, even though they may not need direct support, our teachers have to check in with them. They have to be a support for them. Our numbers of our case management size has actually grown.
But that new law, too, also is going to give families a lot more say in how these services are delivered. So I guess that's my concern, is we may see parents come in and advocate a little stronger for how they want these delivered, that this number may be low. But it's your expertise.
Yes, we'll have to see how that plays out.
We'll see how the law rolls out.
Yeah.
But
we'll have to see how that plays out. To summarize, our enrollment-related requests include a 1.0 foreign language teacher at the middle school, a 1.0 fifth grade teacher at Lane School, a 0.5 reading teacher at the Lane School, and a 0.5 added to FTE and a program administrator stipend for ELL at the Lane School. Second area that of need relates to our expanded building space. So last year we asked for a 1.5 actually of custodial additions. We ended up with a 0.5. That's because of the extra square footage at Lane School, and also the extra square footage of the modulars, which not only are more more absolute area to cover, but they're very complicated, the nooks and crannies, you know, to keep them clean. And our numbers have increased at the Davis School, and so there's just a lot more dirt being tracked in as well. So we're looking to add a 1.0 custodian, and this will bring down the average square footage considerably at both Lane and Davis School, and kind of tee us up for when the Davis School is finished, you know, at the end of next year. Similarly, we've had to contract a lot of services out for HVAC, air conditioning, and heating. We just have more units that need to be serviced than one technician can handle. And so the proposal coming out of facilities is, instead of continuing to have to subcontract out this work, is to have another person on staff. At the same time, as our numbers of custodians and potentially maintenance people has expanded and hopefully will expand some more, there's some management challenges in terms of optimizing everybody's work. And we presently have lead custodians in all four buildings. Tessier is advocating to eliminate one lead position and make it into a foreman who will be responsible for custodians across all four schools, and just, you know, be a source of support and making sure that the same level of cleanliness and the same level of work is happening in each of our buildings. And similarly, to do the same with our maintenance department, to have a four-person there.
So can I ask two questions? If we're seeing an increase in the HVAC to decrease contracting, are we going to see a corresponding decrease elsewhere in the budget to reduce that number that used to go up for contracts?
Yeah, probably by about $20,000-$25,000.
Okay. And then the second piece is, I guess I could ask Tessier if he was here, but isn't that his job to see that all the schools are being cleaned at the same level, or is that not his job?
Well, I mean, no. In the same way that, I mean, a superintendent, you know, is responsible at a certain level, but you still need department heads who are working with the teachers, you know, on the ground floor. So we have, you know, eight custodians at the high school.
Yeah.
You know, four JGMS. So we have a lot of custodians. And Tessier is responsible for not only all the custodial work in the town and the schools, also all the maintenance work, town and schools, all the projects, all the building projects. He can't do that kind of hands-on work.
Okay.
Ron does some of it, but again, Ron is also managing a lot of projects, so this is another kind of a not very costly layer of supervision.
Can I ask
yes.
The increased space, the Davis School, assuming all goes well with that project and the stars align for it, comes online in the 1920 fiscal year.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we hiring custodian for increased space now for the Davis School?
Mm-hmm.
That's the first question.
Yep.
And the second question is, you just said we're spending $20,000 to $30,000 on HVAC contracting. Why would we hire a $61,000 employee to offset $20,000 to $30,000 in HVAC contract?
Mm-hmm. Both very good questions. Right. So the half a person that we got last year met part of the need, met the need at the Lane School, but there was an expansion at the Davis that was never met. by the addition of that 0.5. So the expansion of the modulars is added space that we never increased custodial support for. The other role for this person is to decrease the amount of overtime that we're spending when custodians are out. So when you have 15 custodians or whatever, we have just natural absenteeism, and we have to pay other custodians time and a half to cover those shifts, and that really adds up. So this is to help to offset that as well.
Do you have, or can you provide us with an approximate amount of what that overtime was, so that we can better evaluate what the trade-offs there? I mean, if it works out to 60,000, mm-hmm. I think it's great to have the person in in house, because they're more familiar with the buildings and the people and what's going on, as opposed to somebody who's coming in from outside. But I would just like to know that's where we land with that.
Sure. And then in terms of the maintenance, I think it's a good question, and I've asked Hasir to actually cost out more specifically what the subcontracting is and whether it justifies having somebody, not only is it 61, but $18,000 in addition. So again, this person would help with overtime as well, but I'm not sure it adds up. So I'll have specific numbers for you for next time.
So related to that question, the HVAC technician doesn't just do HVAC though, right? Because they provide other services. They could be doing maintenance. They could be doing snow clearing. They could be doing custodial.
No, they don't do.
They don't do custodial. That custodial, do they?
I mean, the maintenance guys do pretty much everything.
They do
unless
everything.
It's the electrician does. Specifically,
right.
Electrical work or the plumbing.
No, because to me, that's the benefit of having an HVAC person in there,
right.
Is that they don't just do it. If we contract out, they're not going to then come clear our sidewalks when it snows.
Right.
But if we have this HVAC person and we don't have any HVAC needs at that moment, we can deploy them for other responsibilities.
Sure.
That's all.
But then you're thinking about what's the appropriate skill and pay level for that work. If you're paying an HVAC technician $80,000 to do it versus paying a custodian $56,000 to do that work.
Mm-hmm. We'll do a closer cost analysis for next time. Third driver, special education. Just again, I think it's important to see how the distribution of the different kinds of disabilities continues to change. 2008, we had 7% of our students in special ed with autism. Now we're at 12.29, or last year, 12.29. Emotional disabilities, 6%, 15.4%, and what used to be very much the dominant diagnosis, which was a specific learning ability disability, either in math or in reading, has now gone down considerably to 21%.
John, do you know if the if that 7 to 12.29% represents a national increase as well? I mean, is that a reflection of increasing number of students moving to Bedford with that diagnosis, or an increase in diagnosis that would reflect more of a national trend?
So I'm going to let Ann answer that. I would say that there's a national trend upwards.
The numbers
how
are up. More
compare,
kids are being diagnosed.
I'm not sure.
But it's also in the IEP process.
Yeah.
If you're going to, parents used to not say their kids had autism.
Right.
They would say they had a non-specific learning disability. But to get services to really, it's now suggested that parents disclose it and access it. And it's a wild number of kids. That is a kid who's in a SAIL classroom versus a kid who has Asperger's and needs very little support in the classroom. They all have an ASD diagnosis, but they're wildly different. Some of it may be people, there's just more people are being captured. You know where you really notice it is look at the EI numbers. The EI numbers are through the roof because children are being diagnosed earlier.
Yeah. I guess I was wondering about that age-old question that we get asked all the time, is if we build it are, you know, if we build these programs, are people going to flood them? And I don't know whether there's any evidence for that or whether it simply reflects a national trend.
There's just more kids with autism. I think it's just so hard because that 12% is such a varying group of kids.
Yeah, it's a huge range. Okay.
But I will. It is fair to say families will come to good districts. They have no choice. Just like everybody else comes here for the schools, the same is true for people with autism.
I think it might be worthwhile to have that information when you're making the budget presentation.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Will do.
Thanks.
So if you look down at the bottom graph, you'll see that, or the bottom table, that our numbers of in-house students has grown in the last 10 years from 349 to 405 students. Our out-of-district numbers have decreased from 110 to 49 this year. Our total SPED has actually remained relatively consistent at 468. But our numbers, our overall numbers have grown, so the percentage of SPED students has actually gone down by a point or two percentage points.
So I think that those in-house and out-of-district numbers are helpful. I'm not sure the SPED number is that helpful, simply because, similar to Ann's point about like when someone is classified as special education, there's just this massive range and massive number of costs associated with each of those diagnoses. So I like the first two numbers. I just wonder whether we can capture those SPED numbers elsewhere in a way that doesn't, because I think to me that makes the point. 349 to 405 and 110 to 49 is a significant difference, and you can attach a very real number to that. And when I look at special education diagnoses, kids qualifying for services, that's less clear to me.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and I just want to jump back to what we said about autism. I mean, the percentage of students we're talking about is a pretty small number. Mm-hmm. 3 or 4 extra kids move in, that's going to change it wildly. It's not 12% of the district has autism. No. It's not even close.
Right.
It's just our numbers of students that actually have that specific that specific diagnosis has gone up, and 2 or 3 students will skew that number. Mm-hmm. Now, maybe I'm going the wrong way, but I look at I wouldn't call it the SPED headcount, but we'll call it something. It's also helpful to put in the 504 stuff, because we have a lot of students on 504s, and that requires a lot of support that somehow gets lost in translation sometimes.
Yeah, I mean, to me, there's a case to be made about in-district students and personnel that's dedicated to them. That to me makes sense. And then 504, there's just in terms of like the amount of time it takes or the amount of
the meetings,
the sort of energy or requirements around those. Those make sense to me in terms of in-district special education staffing. That's where I would take that number and put that. Mm-hmm. I just for this piece of it,
right?
It feels like it muddies it a little bit.
I mean, that
because I think what someone's going to say is to say, well, your numbers are going down. Why are your costs going down by that much? The point is that each diagnosis costs different, varying. Mm-hmm. Some diagnoses are more expensive than others.
Right. So this is the number of students in the district, whether they have a moderate disability, mm-hmm, and are fully included all the time and just have a 2 times a week they go to a learning center, or a student in the SALE program is fully subseparate. The reason this number is not the sum of these two is because it includes students getting related services, which are students who do not attend Bedford schools but who we actually have to service in their homes, or they come for extra services. So it might be worth breaking that out. In terms of,
what is our percentage of students on IEPs?
On getting related services? It's only 17 kids, approximately. It's a very small number, but
it's... But percentage-wise, I mean, what percentage of students in Bedford are on IEPs?
Are on IEPs?
Yeah. Is it 17? Is it 20? At one point, we were almost...
16.
Which is kind of high.
Yeah. Which is... Yeah.
Given the nature of our district, that's high.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we can play around with how to present this.
Yeah. That might be another, just when we're talking about national averages, that would be an interesting piece too, because there's sort of regional numbers.
Yeah.
Right? So New England tends to be higher than the rest of the country. At the same time, it's still probably pretty far below the New England average.
I can give you data on how many people have autism.
Just in terms of just keep putting perspective on it for people.
I have one in my house. Sorry. Just go home.
Okay.
Bless you.
So even the reason that special education's impact on the FY19 budget is going to primarily be in terms of offsets and some decreases is because we ended up adding staff this year after the FY18 budget had gone to bed and had been approved. And we added a number of teachers, adjustment counselors, and teaching assistants for a number of reasons, but without any impact to the budget. Bless you. So over starting last May through the present, a number of needs have surfaced, either through changes in our population, students moving into Bedford or coming back from out-of-district placements, the appreciation of needs as a result of an evaluation of our bridge program at Lane, JGMS, and the high school, and a recognition that the numbers in our bridge program at the high school were inordinately high and that we couldn't sustain those numbers and provide the services that we needed for kids without burning our teachers out.
So
specifically, we added a 0.4 at the preschool of a 0.4 teacher and a 0.4 TA when we diagnosed several more students with significant autism and had to create a full-day program there because that's what was needed in their IEPs. We only had half-day programs. We added a special ed teacher and an adjustment counselor at the high school for the bridge program. We added 1.3 psychologists, and we added, we're in the process right now of adding 3.5 adjustment counselors and one special ed teacher across the district. By way of offsets, the 0.4 FTE for special ed and the 0.4 TA at the preschool are offset by then being able to add 7 more what we call typical students, regular ed students, who pay tuition. And so their tuition short of $6,000 offset the costs of those additions. The $136,000 that it costs to add the 2 teachers at the high school is more than offset by the $185,560, not including transportation savings that were derived from 3 students coming back to the STEP program from out-of-district placements beginning in the spring. The psychologist position, we eliminated the out-of-district 0.8 position and replaced that with a psychologist. And so the difference was adding 0.5 of a psychologist, and that cost was also absorbed by the bringing back of those 3 students. And then finally, and we went over this about a month ago, pursuant to the evaluation of the bridge program and the decrease in the number of out-of-district students, a netting of 4 out-of-district students, more than pays for those additional staff.
If I could just have a clarification, yes. The out-of-district coordinator was also the assistant director of special education, correct?
No. We had changed that several years ago.
So how long has it been since we've had an assistant special ed director?
3 or 4 years.
I thought the out-of-district coordinator took half, and they did half special assistant director and half out-of-district coordinator, and it was a full-time job.
No. We that model really changed, I think, when Cindy left.
Okay.
That reminds me, just while we're on this topic, we had talked about getting an FTE increase count over the last, 10 years. And I lose sight of the .4s and the .2s and the 1.3s and things like that. So can we just at some point get a, just take like whatever, 7 or 10, last 10 years, how many FTEs we've increased?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think I've got that in here. But
and maybe it's too much information, but it might be helpful. Because Mike had the point of, gosh, the people, who is our special ed student? Is it someone getting an hour a week of speech, or is it someone in the SAIL program? And I don't know how you do it, but sometimes we do it for advocating for additional funding, is to do like a little snapshot. It's a student in the SAIL program gets X, Y, Z, just 3 or 4 bullets.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think folks understand, unless you experienced it in your family or you've advocated for it, you don't really know what all these students are getting. So it's a summer program. It's the educational testing. It's the one-on-one aid. It's the BCBA. It's the sort of who's touching that student.
Yeah. And what kind of services they're getting.
And what they're getting. And not going into exact detail, but just sort of to give them a sample, a real flavor for what that is. Versus a student who's in the Bridge program or a child who's has dyslexia and is using Orton-Gillian. Like, it just gives a better sense of what it is. And I think that would be useful for people.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think most folks realize that.
No, I think that's a great suggestion. That table is not complete, but it gives you an idea.
Yep.
And this gives you the differences.
Thank you.
And I'd love to help you do it if you need it.
That'd be great. So. Thank you. Projecting into FY19, given this increase in staffing to date, we don't project a need for additional staffing, with the caveat that we always have to meet the needs of the kids in front of us. So, you know, if those needs change, then we're going to have to meet them. So the overall impact on in terms of cost to the FY19 budget is an increase in our end of year, our summer, additional summer work by $15,000, and supplies and some contract services, $10,000, so about $25,000. But the offsets are significant. The 1.082 million, this is circuit breaker. And then some additional savings that are factored into the maintenance of effort budget derived from credits from lab. That we have accumulated at 292,287. So these two figures help to decrease our overall budget for FY19. Any questions there? Okay. Fourth driver, program improvements in terms of personnel. We need to increase our reading support at the high school by 0.5. We presently have a 0.5 reading teacher at the high school. Between the one-on-one Wilson or Orton-Gillingham kind of tutorial work that needs to be done and small group work, we still have a number of kids who need direct reading support at the high school, 0.5. The high school would like to have a campus aide to help maintain security on campus, checking on doors, supporting orderly behavior in the hallways, especially during the new flex block, et cetera, and right after school when we have a lot of kids who are in the building unsupervised. So that would be equivalent to a TA position. At Davis, when we went to the full-time kindergarten from 4 days to 5 days, we didn't have the budget at that time to have our education assistants go full-time. And so we have a real hole there where just that support in each of the kindergarten classrooms ends around an hour and a half or so before the end of the day. And that really impacts what teachers can do and the close attention that they can give to their students. So we'd like to make all those education assistants whole at 22,778. We have a computer aide at the Lane School who's a 0.8. and who maintains the inventory, readies the computers, keeps them charged, and assists in the computer lab with students and with teachers. Again, that person leaves before the end of the day. We'd like to be able to add a point two so that person can be there full time. And then Lane and Davis share an instructional technology specialist who's at each building half time. Their demand for more and more use of instructional technology, integrating new kinds of programs with both our iPads and our Chromebooks, really needs professional development and the kind of hands-on support to help keep teachers know how to do that, how to build student portfolios, all kinds of programming. So we'd like to make it so that there's a full-time person at Davis and a full-time person at Lane by adding the 1.0.
Can we at some point get from Heather a description of what the campus aid specifically would do?
Yes.
Because I think it's probably, she probably has a pretty clear vision for it.
Yeah.
I hope her vision isn't just to take care of kids who are coming late for Xbox. It drives me crazy enough that they're coming late, and it would drive me even crazier if we had to pay $25,000 to make sure they're getting in safely. But my suspicion is that she has a far clearer idea of kind of how she specifically wants to use them.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think so. I'll let
Thank
her
you.
Speak to that. And then our last driver is program improvements resources. I'll just kind of call out the four larger, more costly items. Our calculus project, which you got a firsthand look at when Patrick presented and his students presented earlier this year. We want to be able to include more students and more time for kids with their summer math program. We want to add additional Chromebook carts at Lane and JGMS, $42,500. We're moving more towards Chromebooks to balance out our iPads. They have different functions. We need to upgrade system-wide smart software so that our smart boards work as efficiently as possible with the most current applications, 21250, and then some of the contract supplies and textbooks adding up to 28951. And then the specific breakdown of these things are on the next three pages. And I think we'll just, instead of going through them one by one, if you have questions about them, either David or I can try to answer them.
I have a question.
Yes.
How many Chromebooks are there to a cart?
30.
30? Okay. And is that true of all the technology? Because I describe it as so many carts, but they're all 30?
Yes.
Okay. So that gives most classes enough for every kid and then a couple of extras in case something's not functioning properly?
Yes, it certainly covers whole classrooms. You know, they're being used in different ways. So a lot of the elementary classrooms are using these, instead of having every kid have one, they're using them as stations. And so might be three or four different classes sharing one cart. So there might be, you know, six or seven kids using them per classroom times five classes or four classes. So if you want to come back to that, I'd be glad to address any specifics. And then kind of by way of summary, the overall salary increase, which includes the COLA, steps and lanes, teachers moving up, plus our new hires, 5.68%. Our non-salary is actually a minus 1.43%. And that, again, is largely due to the decrease in out-of-district costs, you know, that that we're still benefiting from. Our changes to staff, in terms of our student-teacher ratio, when we look at core subjects, and core subjects means math, science, social studies at the secondary level, and regular classroom teachers at the elementary level were about 19.4 student-teacher ratio. It's a much lower ratio if you take all of our teachers. It's down 11-12 if you include all of our small classrooms. And this table summarizes the FTE changes from FY18 proposed to FY18 actual to FY19 proposed. And you'll see that the changes in regular ed are actually relatively small. We actually had a decrease in regular ed because of some offsets going to the actual, and then we'll bump up again this year. But the significant change in terms of additional teachers is in special ed. And please note that this jump from 56 to 65 includes the addition of the preschool starting in these in the actual FY18 and the projected FY19. They're not included in the proposed FY18 or before we had them separated out. So there's 5.1 teachers at the preschool. That's included in that jump from 56 to 65.
Is it also accurate to say that those positions we added mid-year with the added district offsets and the adjustment counselors is the other piece of
that? That's the
that's
yes,
what
exactly.
The piece that FinCom approved.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I just want to make sure that's the big jump, but I know that that accounts for the other half of that.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, the special ed and preschool numbers, that doesn't include special ed aides, that's teachers, right?
Just professional teachers, yeah, thank professional you. Staff.
And how... What percentage of the preschool are paying to go, and how much money do we the schools make? Is that it's probably
so. The number of students paying tuition, I think is about 17.
Mm-hmm. Out of the 40 something.
Mm-hmm.
And then I guess the other point to make there is that 56.2 to 65.9, one of the things we said in our finance committee presentation was if we're able to add them now, we won't have to add them in 19, which is why that number 65.9 reflects 65.9 for the next projection.
Correct.
So it's about where they fit in, but not we'd rather have them fit in between 18 and 18 rather than 18 to 19.
Right, and we have the need now, and we're able to do it without increasing the budget now.
Yeah, just making good on the promise that we said is if we add them now, we won't have to add them later.
Correct. Yeah. This gives the salary breakdown in terms of what the COLA cost is, what the steps and lanes are. Again, if you have specific questions about that, I'm sure David will be happy to answer. This is actually last year's comparisons. I will have this all updated by the next time you see this presentation. This takes a look at what Bedford's average teacher salary is relative to about 20 other districts, and also compares our average housing asking price, our average single-family tax bill, our single-family average value, and our residential property tax. And the reason that this is included is because we often get questions about what the impact of our teachers' contract is on our budget. And I think it's
helpful. I'm not a Concord resident, but if I was, I would have some questions about their average teacher salary.
Yeah.
Average teacher salary.
Yeah.
Boy, that's, you ought to see who they
are. Now
okay. Yeah. That's helpful.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And also, I think that the single family home average is really important because we compare ourselves to Lexington all the time.
We're not Lexington. Yeah.
But their single family home value is $932,000.
Right.
And that is a significant jump from 595.
Right.
So that's
and
just,
their
that's
average asking price is 1.4.
So I would love to see this updated.
Yeah, it'll be updated.
That's a really helpful chart. Thank you for that.
And look at how high Burlington is.
That's the stunner.
Yeah.
But they pay their teachers more out of the gate
Yeah.
and pay them less over time.
They sure do.
Yeah. Now, the one thing that we have to be careful about with this, and that's why what I'm going to add are also the kind of the starting bachelor's, start ending bachelor's, is
the,
the averages also are impacted by how old your staff
yep.
is.
Yeah,
right?
Concord.
So Concord, I mean, Concord definitely pays a lot higher also,
but, they have more
but
degrees.
It means they have more senior staff
more
as
degrees.
Well.
Yeah, so in a given year, they could fall pretty far down that list if they get a number of retirees.
They could fall.
That's interesting.
They won't let that happen.
But that's why I'll have the kind of contractual numbers yeah. so people can see where we fit in that.
Thank you.
And we're well within the middle back there.
And the sad part is this is all going to change next year when property taxes are no longer deductible. You know, it's going to have a big impact on all of us.
Operating expenses, again, the specific breakdowns, if you have questions, I'd be glad to come back. Special ed costs, out-of-district costs. And then these are the offsets that David uses, and he can speak to any questions that you have about the offsets.
Can you clarify what the offsets are? Because I think I know, but I may not.
What they are?
Yeah, What are the offsets? What are they for?
Well, they're broken out there by.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't see the table.
So you have federal.
Okay.
IDEA.
That's the IDEA. That's the special ed. Medical 142 special ed law. Federal E-rate, which we get money or have in the past for reimbursements for the information technology. Primarily through phone service, but that's been scaled back.
So essentially, they're state and federal reimbursement, mm-hmm. and from other sources like the Mudge Fund.
Right.
Okay.
Things that we utilize as purely as revenue sources that we apply directly to the budget.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
All right. What you won't see up here is the biggest number, which is a Chapter 70. Because that goes directly to the town.
Again,
the budget roll-up, just so you can see the salaries, 5.6%, operating expenses, 4.6%, special ed OD, actually down 9.49%. Transportation, special ed transportation's up a bit, but the overall non-salary is down. And regular ed transportation is up, so that brings us to the 4.31. Revolving funds, it's a little hard to see the policies, but David has prepared this chart for us that gives us what each of the revolving funds is, what the actual amount of reserve is that's there, and what the school committee policy directs in terms of what should be maintained as a balance.
So, David, on another year, I remember when we first were coming up with these policies, and now they've been sort of codified as policies, we were talking about, like, this is the target, and we were sort of giving ourselves a grade on that.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just give us that one-sheeter again sometime? Maybe it's a quick presentation by you, but it's just in terms of, like, maybe it has it there.
Yeah, we added it to the...
Oh, all right, perfect, yep.
Would it be possible to get a copy that's a little larger?
Yes, I guess that's what it is.
Thank you.
What, the one in your book doesn't work?
Yeah. I guess it's in kind of mouse
yes.
print. But
oh, my goodness.
It's like, so I remember yeah. one year, David, you did a thing where it sort of said, like, here's the fund, here's the balance, here's the goal, the target, the school committee policy, and we were either on target, above target, or below target.
Right.
And it's probably just a matter of putting it all in one page.
Okay.
But,
yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, I see it.
In your original, yeah. you see it, it's actually larger. Just let me know is that
very
readable?
Visible.
Okay.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. All right. And this is our historical waterfall chart that, David, do you feel like just kind of taking them through
sure.
this?
Sure. What we try to do here is, on the far left, is start with the base budget and then either add or subtract by the category that we have below here.
Which is hard to see.
Steps and lanes being the biggest singular one, but then the out-of-district costs, regular transportation, out-of-district transportation. Not sure what that is, but so each of these categories drives the budget need up or down, depending on what the net value is. And then we get to the new position, and then the new operating expenses. And we break out information technology because it's a big, it could be a big number, plus or minus. So there's some small offsets and things that just drive. And then the final number is the final for the budget.
So this is my favorite chart. If we could just do the budget in one slide, this would be it.
Sure.
So the only thing this chart is missing is that important line that reads
what the
guidelines. Finance Committee guideline is.
Yeah. All right. Yep. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so it sounds, is that it?
Yeah, there's the budget to actuals, but again, if you have specific questions.
Let's just take it with, we'll start with Chris. Chris, do you have any questions about the way this town is spending all their money? At least on schools. No questions, all right. Anne, do you have any questions or comments?
Yes, I do. So our FinCom guideline is 3.5%, and obviously this number is over it, so we'll start the process that we go through each year, but I guess it's too soon to say if we're confident we can meet that number, or we'll go through the process, see what we come at, and then we'll make a decision. With the... I'm still a little confused, and I'm probably going deeper than I need to. Middle school foreign language. The classes, the students that do take them are in classrooms with 30 people in the class. But not every student at the middle school takes a foreign language, because a lot of the kids on IEPs can't, because that's when all the services are given, correct?
No, I don't think that's correct. I think it's the, I think
we've
the kids...
We've pushed more kids in, so
yes.
They're not, so now they can be in foreign languages?
Yes.
Good.
It's
so that
typically
would also,
the kids who, there may be an overlap between kids with IEPs and kids with
reading
2 or 3 years below
right.
grade level. And to the degree that that overlap is there, yes.
So right. that may also add to our increased need for more Spanish teachers, because it
yes.
used to be these students could not access, and that was a challenge. So that's wonderful to see that they can.
Yeah.
And the reading, I am concerned about the new law with respect to ELL students and how more accommodating it's going to have to be. Perhaps the state will send more money that way, because it turns out the person who wrote the law is chairman of Ways and Means, so he understands how the money works. But I have some concerns that we may be low on our ELL, but you know that better than I do. And we'll just see as that law rolls out, and I guess if a need develops, you'll come back to us and tell us. But it may be worth putting a footnote or highlighting that for FinCom, because it's really tough to anticipate what that's going to be. But what I'm hearing is it could be very good for students, but it may change how we deliver services. Yeah. And then just the ideas of adding slides for special ed. And then I almost think it's too busy. It's too hard to understand, but we could make it a little. There's so many kids in it, it's hard to put everybody in a slide.
You're talking about the different services and
right,
related to different diagnoses. And
yeah,
those. Yeah.
Because
I think
when
we
you
can
first
give a
look
snapshot
that,
that gives an idea.
Yeah, because I think you look at the slide and you think 12% of the kids in Bedford have autism, and that's simply not the case. It's just not an understanding math or understanding why the numbers jumped or why it looks the way it does. And we can put more information in how many kids are diagnosed, how it's changed in the last 10 years, how many kids are diagnosed. Question. With clarification with respect to the campus aid, is that like a security guard? I guess I'm having trouble picturing what that is.
That's why I asked that question.
Right. Is it a security
guard? I think
Heather
should be able to give us. I think she probably has a pretty clear vision, would be my guess.
Okay. And then the Davis Lane Tech Instructional Coach, that's for staff, that's for teachers, or who?
Yes.
So we realize I just need to ask this. We couldn't bring someone in periodically to do that. They need to be there full time to train staff.
So
Because the hard part is that person always gets benefit. They get everything that goes along with it. And it's always that dance of, do we just hire someone as a consultant, bring them in as needed, or do we really need someone full-time?
So do you want me to try to answer, or come back with more specifics?
Yeah, come back with more specifics. I think that would be really helpful on that.
Okay.
I don't disagree that we probably need it, but I need more information. And then with respect to the ELL person, the 0.5 FTE ELL and then PA stipend, is that one person or two people? I'm having trouble understanding that one. Is it going to be a half-time teacher? Is that the idea?
Yes, half-time. So it'll actually be, so right now we have 1.9 teachers at Lane.
Right.
So 0.1 of that new 0.5 will actually go to the to the 0.9 and make that person whole.
Should we have always made that person whole, or did we come in thinking they could just do it?
We've actually gradually increased her. She was 0.8 a year ago. We added 0.1. Now we need. So the needs are greater.
Because this is the question I always ask. Mm-hmm. Do you get a better person if it's a 1.0 position?
Right. So we are. She's great.
I'm sure she's wonderful. Yeah.
She's now. You know, she's ready to be full-time, and we need her full-time.
Right.
Then the 0.4 that's left over and the 0.5 that's coming from the high school will make up for...
Is she going to be one person or two people, or he?
We're actually going to add one whole person and somebody who's already in district will become the coordinator. So we're adding a whole person. But we're borrowing a piece from the high school to do it. So
I
we're getting a whole
that.
Person.
It's just because I'm not a teacher, I like that idea, that one point, that
it's
whole
always,
person
always
walking
better,
in the room.
Almost always better. Every once in a while you hit the jackpot and you get somebody who wants to be part-time who's excellent.
Okay.
So in this case, yes, it'll be a whole person.
And then to Joanne's questions, you're going to give more information on the building space people. And are these the only when we look at the program improvements, resources, big tickets, is this the only thing we're adding? Like, are there going to be, I know we had looked at maybe looking at meditation, different programs at the high school, dealing with stress and all that. I don't see anything on the budget for this. Did that not make the cut this year?
Well, we've got a grant. We've done a grant for that.
But if we don't get it, it would have to wait a year.
But part of the increase in adjustment counselor staff is to be able to have on staff people do more training, both for kids and for staff around social emotional issues.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
And I ask it every year, but I'm just going to put it out there. Some districts do not put their out of districts in their regular school budget. Burlington does not, and I just wish sometimes maybe. Out-of-districts are not failures. They're kids who have really complex needs who need to go to schools that we can't possibly meet their needs. And sometimes I just wonder, at some point, do we move in that direction where we just take it out of our school budget and so that it doesn't always, because I think sometimes it always looks like we did something wrong, that all those kids had to go to those schools. And that if we somehow can't meet their needs and serve them in the district, we've somehow failed. We always look at it as a good thing that a kid doesn't go out of district, and I have to disagree and say it's not.
No.
And you just take it out of the budget and say that's going to be its own separate department, that it doesn't impact the school budget. Because at some point there's going to be no more out of districts to take away. We pay for a lot of things now.
Well, different towns do it very differently. Arlington, for example, their finance committee gives them a separate percentage for special ed, all special ed. They get 7% automatically for all special ed. And then they get 3.5-4% for their regular budget. So that's one way of doing it. Burlington, all their out of district is out of their budget and is paid for directly by the town. I actually, right now, I mean, I want to think about what you're saying, but I like the fact that we consider them part of our overall.
I think that you can make that argument, but then it's always looked at. Or some folks look at it like that was a negative, that Bedford had all those kids go out of district. And that wasn't necessarily a negative. And so I don't want to look like every time the number goes down that we're doing a better job. Mm-hmm. It's just that we're offering more in district, but some of those kids still won't be able to go. So I just had to offer it. I propose it every year. Thank you.
Sarah.
All right. I just want to chime into the reduced class size discussion and say that I'm also complex is good. I wanted to just make sure that was known. I'm curious about the custodian breakdowns of money and the campus aid, those questions. So I just want to, it was mostly reiterating and I'm mostly absorbing. I found my nursery school answer was in the revolving funds. So thank you. I think that's it. Thanks.
Joanne.
I have a couple of questions. To go back to Ann's question about the reading staff, you have a position being added at Lane half-time that's for about $47,000, and reading half, 0.5 FTE addition in reading at the high school, that's quite a bit less. And I was trying to understand, are they for the same position, or they're doing like a reading teacher versus a paraprofessional?
No, the one at Lane is an existing staff member who will go full time, and therefore, because that staff member actually has a lot of experience, that salary would be higher than somebody. Actually, they're both making somebody full time, but the person at the high school is just much less senior.
Okay, that's fine. That answers that. So under athletics, there's an increase requested to pay for an orthopedic physician to attend the home football games. Mm-hmm. Setting aside the question of whether students should be playing a sport that is so dangerous that it requires a physician to be here, is this something that would be requested by other teams, say the soccer team or field hockey or lacrosse? And is it actually a physician, or is it a like a PT or a trainer or a physician assistant or nurse practitioner?
Have to get back to you on that one.
Okay.
I do have to say, we did have a mom one day at a lacrosse game who was a physician, but she's an obstetrician, so she said, should I go out and help? And I said, are they having a baby? Like, I don't think. But she, it was great she was there. She was willing to pitch in.
Something that I had asked about last year, I was wondering about, is the substitute pay has not changed. Are we paying, are we meeting
minimum wage
laws? If it's, how do you explain the fact that it is not changed, and are we meeting our obligations, not only according to law, but in terms of
priorities?
I guess justice and what you would think is right. I mean, you don't want to have somebody as a substitute who could be making more working at McDonald's. Not that there's, I think they're both honorable positions, but I just would hope that we would have somebody who has some level of skills, mm-hmm. who would be substituting when there's not, when the teachers are out, mm-hmm. taking their well-deserved and I'm sure much needed sick days and personal days. And also, supply costs for art and music, and are they changing? Are we meeting those needs as well?
So I'm just going to give partial answers now, because I think it would be better to really give thought to all your questions. But we've been considering trying to raise our substitute pay, partly just to be more competitive and get more substitutes, because we've really suffered. We instituted for this year a new system of automating our substitute calling, which is supposed to yield some results, because substitutes get earlier notice and they're not the last ones to get called. So kind of waiting to see how what difference that's making, which is not the same as your question about, you know, what a decent wage is. But that is a concern. So we'll come back with some numbers the next time. You know, our program administrators are good advocates for their programs. I'm not, if we're not seeing more being requested for art music, I think it means that they feel that they're well supplied at this point.
Okay. And then the last thing is just that custodial FTE at Davis, if they've been able to meet the needs the last, I mean, how long have the portable units been there? Several years. And they've been able to meet the needs. Why are we asking for it now when we're really going to need it is for fiscal year 2020?
Okay. The only thing I've noticed with going into Davis is there's so much more stuff and people. Yeah. That what it was to clean that building 4 years ago versus what it must be to do it now is harder. But it's only going to get harder as we add more. So.
And today I was there, and I, since you have to park and walk up, the right around immediately the school, the sidewalks are clear, but all the way down to the parking lot is an ice rink. So that's just another job for them. But it. But everybody, I mean, grandparents and parents and kids are slipping around, so.
Thank you. That it?
That's it.
Thank you. Dan?
So it seems to me like we're chasing down a $218,000 difference between guideline and where we are now.
Thank you, Dan.
It is what it is. I think that there's a lot of stuff in this budget that we're seeing that we certainly have to do. I think there is some stuff that we like to do. I think we'll hash out the difference as we get through the process. A couple of questions on page five. The directionality of that chart is a little confusing because we're going backwards as we read from right to left. So if we just swap it over so we're seeing the increase like the rest of the charts, that would be awesome. The enrollment increasing complex goes reverse chronologically as you go across the page. Can't read my own handwriting now. That's a wonderful job, Dan. I'm looking at the high school numbers and the projections year to year, and it seems like we do look for decline each year as kids go through BHS. I'm looking that for next year, we're looking at a minus 11, 9th to 10th, and a minus 5, 10th to 11th. Is that pretty standard that we see 5 to 10 kids attrit out as they move through BHS per year? That's about it.
I mean, what you have with the high school, you do have kids from Hanscom moving in and out.
Yep.
And some years we've had as many as 20 have come in, come out, back and forth. You also have Shawsheen and Minuteman that you do lose a few kids from, even from the opening of school to the October submission.
So. On the additional lane teacher on the bottom of page six, we knew that was coming. That's not a surprise that we need the
Correct.
Additional teacher. So that was something that was always in the long-term projections. We add the classroom, we need the teacher.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good to know. Page five. The calculus, expanded calculus project in summer math, would that be more students the way that it was described to us earlier, or more students slash for all students, if that program expands?
The summer program could be for all students.
Okay, great. I also have a question about Chromebooks, and maybe I missed it at some point, but have we had a presentation about the specific uses for iPads and Chromebooks recently, so we can see how they're both being used?
Not recently.
I think
no.
That would be helpful. I think for me and perhaps all of us understand, like, we want to support that, but like, let's really see how those are both being used, and that would be great. The chart of the towns I've always loved, I think I've asked before, and maybe it isn't a good idea, but I would like to see on those towns also the percentage of the town budget that goes to schools. I know it isn't exactly apples to apples, but you know, it's worth noting that, you know, yes, Lexington does X, but also they spend 55% of their budget on schools or whatever, and how does that compare to other towns? I think that might also be informative if only to make myself feel better about my nerdiness.
As long as those numbers help.
Yeah. My other question, which jumped out at me because I was looking at it, is on page 17 in the revolving funds. It looks like in the school rental number, we're seeing a huge increase for next year of $100,000 in the projection. Is that based on something or is that a typo?
I'd have to check that.
Because we're going from $85,000 in FY18 to $182,000 in FY19 in the projection.
No, that is incorrect.
Okay, so that seems like a big difference. I think that's all that I have.
Thank you.
Thank you, it's great stuff.
So you've captured most of this, but just in terms of a to-do list that I think is, David, that idea about the goals for the revolving accounts, mm-hmm. and I guess the question from there is, you know, can we get that on one, you have all the information, just putting it on one page, but then the question we should ask is, should we make some decisions? You know, should we send some of that down? Should, you know, so that's the question I think,
sure.
I would love to have that just be like a separate item,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? And then the FTE increase over 10 years, that chart, Heather's campus aid description, Tissier's analysis of the HVAC FTE, that line on the waterfall chart, and just the updated district comparisons. I'll email you those. Just
okay,
so you have
them. I got it.
And I guess specific to Ann's question, it'll be important for you to start working on with your principals, with your teachers, about what their priorities are if we have to move from 4.31 to 3.5, because we're going to start asking those questions. So
mm-hmm.
I guess to Dan's question as well. Yep. So I'm sure you're having those conversations.
Yep.
That's the next step in this process for us to say, we get to stay on our side, here's what we would prioritize, and then John gets to say, here's what my principals and teachers are prioritizing, and we kind of see whether we can get to that 3.5 or whether we can't.
Yeah, and it is, I think, then, respectfully, I think it's 318. It's 80% of about 400,000. What? I mean, of 40
yep,
million.
18.
Gets to see.
So,
this is
heavy 18, right?
FinCom.
You did.
Version.
Yeah, so I'm just looking at. We're scheduled for.
I don't keep changing.
2 weeks.
Yep.
Perfect. We'll have all this ready.
Great. Thank you for that. And just a thanks in advance, because I know that it's very easy for us to ask those questions, and then actually getting that information and putting it in a usable chart, I realize is a much more large task. So thank you in advance. Anything else on the budget? Chris, it's your last chance. You ready? Okay. All right, Davis School updates.
So I'm going to collapse the Davis School update with the superintendent's report because we've been on vacation. There isn't a lot more to report. I'm going to ask Joanne to kind of...
I'll start it.
Start us off.
Chime in. So the Davis School Building Committee met on, I think it was December 19th, to discuss a couple of things. The first one was what we wanted to see for siding on the addition. And we talked about a couple of options of like a brick face and metal siding. And I that sounds worse than it is. It's very lovely. It's like the a metal panel siding that's kind of modern looking, and it was used on the Lane School in sections, and it really breaks up the way that it looks, and it is apparently very durable. And the group, with the exception of one person abstaining, voted to have that siding. Then the architects, who really have earned every penny the town has paid them, thought of another option for the school, so it would enable us to add a pod, which is kind of like the common space between a group of classrooms and two classrooms on the second floor for, they think, $300,000 to $400,000. And it would also include an open courtyard space on the second floor. So the group for the committee overall voted to include that as an add-alt on the contract. So that would allow the contractors to say, okay, within this budget, we think that we can get all of this done, or we might be able to also get this done if costs come out lower. So it's basically one of those things that if we think we have the extra money within within the budget. If the other costs come out a little on the low side, and the metal siding is one of the ways that they would value engineer the project to get a little bit more savings, then we might be able to afford to do that. But we won't know until the bids come in. The bids will be back the week prior to spring town meeting. In talking about that, that would essentially give the Davis School 11 kindergarten, first and second grade classrooms. Beth, who is the principal at the Davis School, said, you know, if we use them all as classrooms with students, it could have implications for the specials, for the art and music classes. But there's also an opportunity to use it for some other purposes. The group had a discussion about the fact that if we're able to do this, we need to have the internal discipline, the self-discipline, to make sure that if we use some of those classrooms for other purposes, that if enrollment increases beyond what we have projected, that we make sure that we'll be able to convert that space back to classrooms, so that we're not coming back in a couple of years and saying, oh, guess what, we need a couple more classrooms there. So that was that. So the group had, the committee voted to include that adult option on the contract.
So thank you very much. I would just add a couple things. So the genesis of this, or the evolution of this, is that originally we were going to add two additional classrooms, part of what we are planning for, where the modular classrooms are, after the other side was done. And what we realized about a month or so ago was that it actually will save money if, instead of putting them there, we put them on top of the single story. Because there isn't the same foundation work, and it works really well. And that we can do that because we're adding enough classes on the northeastern side, we can do that and still meet the same timelines. Once they looked at that and they costed it out and realized that's going to save some money and the siding is going to save some money, it became possible to just add another classroom or two up and to kind of fill out that space.
Makes sense.
And because a lot of parents have said, are you sure you're building enough? You're sure you're building enough? And we are building enough based on, you know, our projections, based on the information we have. Now, since then, of course, there's this talk about allowing more two-family to be replaced in teardowns, and there's this talk about the Bedford Motel. So it could be real positive to have some extra classrooms. But the committee didn't feel that it was judicious at this point to try to arrest the process, given the time frame, and say to everybody, hey, wait a minute. And so the decision was to put it in as an adult. Based on how successful we were with contingency fund use, et cetera, with the Lane School, there's certainly a possibility that we'll have a good portion of that available.
Great. Thank you for that update. Any questions on that? Chris, any questions? No. Ann?
None.
Sarah?
No.
Dan?
Anything on the roof? Anything new on the roof?
Nope. The capital expenditures did not include the roof.
Was it final?
Yeah, no, they did not include the roof.
Was it deferred to a later year? Was it taken off the list?
It's deferred to a later year. The feeling among the members who prevailed in the vote was that Tessier and his staff are doing such an excellent job taking care of the roof that's there, that it can stay on. Where I forget which year it had been scheduled to be replaced, but they felt that was what we should continue.
It was leaking at the basketball game on December 23rd.
Okay, well.
So, I mean, the building committee continues to think that it's, you know, it doesn't affect our project, but we think that it just makes fiscal sense. And so it's still, you know, ultimately it's in the selectmen's hands.
Okay.
Whether
did they hear about that at the presentation of capital to the selectmen? Did the roof come up?
Were they at basketball?
Presentation?
No.
Well, now there'll be less of the roof, right?
Have presented to the selectmen on Monday before. Did the roof come up in that conversation?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
And I believe one of the selectmen advocated for including it.
Okay.
And
be sure to thank Mike Worth.
Oh, I was thinking Carolyn Redd.
All right. Good. All right. Thank you. Anything else in the superintendent's report?
No, thank you.
Great. Let's look at minutes to approve. I have accept the motion for any member of the committee to approve the minutes of the Bedford School Committee on November 21st, 2017.
So moved.
Dan moves. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Joanne second. Ian, I'll start with you. Any corrections there?
I did not have any corrections.
Sarah, none?
Mm-mm.
Joanne, none?
No.
Dan, none?
None.
None to me as well. So in that case, we'll take a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any any opposed?
None opposed.
And any abstentions?
I abstain.
Two abstain. So that one is approved 3-0-2. With that, any other additional business we want to add? Requests? Items you'd like to discuss, reflect upon? Nothing?
I'm sorry, yes. If we could just ask, remember we looked at that policy on harassment? Mm-hmm. Did they ever get back to us as to whether we needed to update it or not? Or I guess you'll tell us at another meeting?
I'll tell you another.
Thank you. That's it.
With that, I will accept the motion from any member of the committee to adjourn.
So moved.
Dan moves. Anyone second?
Second.
Sarah seconds. We'll do so with a roll call vote. Anne?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
Joanne?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
And I am a yes. We are out of session at 9:25, not to be reopened tonight. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.